Welcome to episode 2 of the Between Two Beers podcast. On today's show, we speak with Kiwi footballing legend Paul Nixon. Nikko came to New Zealand as a 23-year-old from Sunderland, where he played for Gisborne City, got signed by Bristol Rovers, played 5 years there, 5 years in Hong Kong, back to Gisborne, played for Waikato United in Melville, and is one of New Zealand football's greatest exports. Yep, we're claiming him. He played for the All Whites. He then got into his coaching, took Melville to the 2003 Chatham Cup final, and was a huge influence on the schoolboy scene in Hamilton. And now he's here on the podcast. So great, Al. I really enjoyed this hour chat. Covered a lot of ground, bounced around a lot. We spoke about his punch-up with Gerry Francis on a team bus at Bristol. We spoke about his breakdown and his relationship with Declan Edge following the 2003 Chatham Cup final. We spoke about the tragedy of losing his wife to cancer and raising his 4 kids by himself and how that changed his perspective on life, and we spoke about where he's at now. So great, really great hour. If you like what we're doing here and you're interested in seeing the best bits, we're going to clip out the highlights and put them on the Between Two Beers Facebook page. So give that a like and a follow, and yeah, hope you enjoy. Paul Nixon, welcome to Between Two Beers.
Good evening.
So it's the second episode of Between Two Beers. Great guest tonight, Mr. Paul Nixon. Bit of an interesting story about how we actually got him on the podcast. I gave him a call yesterday afternoon and I said, "Nikko, do you know what a podcast is?" And he said, "Well, I actually found out what a podcast is this morning. I was getting my hair done at a hair salon, and Gucci, Rana, shout out Gucci, friend of the show, said, 'Have you heard the podcast? Steve and Shay have got something going with Aaron Scott, and it was a good listen.'" And so by that conversation, you knew what a podcast was, and a few hours later, you were invited on a podcast. So what an absolute pleasure having you here tonight, Paul, for your first real podcast experience. The way that we do things here at Between Two Beers is we like to talk about how we know the guest and our relationship to give a bit of context for the listeners. So I'll start. Paul was my high school football coach and Melville youth team coach. His coaching career and my playing career basically worked off the same trajectory. Yeah, all through boys high. Well, since fifth form at boys high and the Melville under 19 team, we worked together. He would probably, well, him and Roger Wilkinson would be the two biggest influences on my career as a striker. I looked up to Paul. He was great to learn off in terms of striking ability because he had it all. And it sort of culminated in the 2003 Chatham Cup final. I left for America after that, and Nikko kind of vanished in a big ball of smoke. We'll get into the reasons behind that and where he went afterwards. But I know Nikko very well, so looking forward to a good chat. And yeah, Shay, how do you know?
I probably don't know Nikko as well as you do. I think the first, actually no, I do know, the first time I come across you was I was playing for Claudeland. It was 2000. You were playing for Melville. We were on Gower Park number 3. Pre-season game, we lost. I don't think you scored it, but someone scored a goal, and you were so happy with the way that the goal was scored. Something about the build-up, I don't know whether the team was working on something, I thought, who's this old guy getting so happy about this pre-season game? And then I kind of only really knew about the myth of Nikko when Stephen and some of the younger lads would talk about you and the under-19s and bits and pieces. And then I guess over the last few years, we've kind of just been in and around Waikato football. I see you on Sundays watching Melville under-16 Academy games, kind of pottering around here and there. And I often talk about you with your daughter up at New Zealand Football, who's doing very, very well. So that's my kind of Nikko story, just kind of overlapped and have been in the same place at the same time.
Good. I feel like that's a good solid intro. A lot about his coaching. We're going to get into his playing career as well. And I want to start off, we've been doing our research on you, Nikko. So we've been searching, you know, the most interesting stories.
We're going to start at perhaps the most intriguing one, and I didn't actually know about this until we started looking into you. So I'm going to read an excerpt from that we found from the Express UK paper, dated February 8th, 1990, and it reads, Gerry Francis, Bristol Rovers manager, ended up in a police station in the early hours of yesterday after an alleged punch-up with one of his players. Police were called to the Post House Hotel at Heathrow, where the team coach had stopped just before midnight to celebrate a victory at nearby Brentford. Former England skipper Francis and his New Zealand international winger Paul Nixon were involved in a row. Nixon, 27, had been asked to help with the team baggage, but refused after being dropped for the game. He claimed that Francis, 28, struck him, and both men went to West Drayton Police Station. Now, to put that in a little bit of context, I've been trying to think of a current day analogy, because Gerry Francis was a year older than you at the time, and he was a former England captain. So I think the equivalent might be someone like Tim Payne going from the National League here in New Zealand to Derby last year in the Championship, managed by Frank Lampard, former England captain, and getting dropped for a game, getting asked to do some sort of team duties, refusing, and then getting in a punch-up with Lampard. So it was back page news across all the big papers in England, from what I understand. I would love your perspective and what happened. Talk us through it.
Well, thank you for inviting me onto your podcast. Let's go back 30 years. All right. Now, it's funny enough, I've been invited back to Bristol Rovers for their anniversary after 30 years of going to Wembley.
Is Gerry going to be there?
Yes. So this happens in March of next year. So I'm going back for it. But going back 30 years to that event is it's not one I'm proud of. And I'm quite lucky that I actually got out of it and still had my pro contract on me. The story behind it was, Gerry had just signed a new striker from Stoke City. Can't remember his name. And he made his debut in the League Cup. I think it was a League Cup game. And I got dropped. And I was disappointed. Not that I got dropped, but he didn't tell me I was dropped. He named the team.
Wow.
And I wasn't in it. So I was very upset by that, so I found a pub and I had a few drinks and I watched the game.
When you found that, so you weren't on
you the, weren't team, in the team sheet?
No, I wasn't on the team sheet.
Okay. Was it home game or away game?
Away game.
So you've travelled with the team?
Yeah, travelled with the team.
Found out you're not in the squad?
Yeah.
And then
just,
I'm off.
I've gone to a local pub because there was another lad that travelled with me, and Pete Corley, who was ex-commando in the army, but he got released early for some indiscretion, and he turned out to be a pro footballer later on in life. So he was from London, and we went to a pub just outside the ground, and I got well-oiled, went back, watched the game, went into the changing rooms after the game. I didn't say anything other than when Gerry approached me and told me I had to pick up the kit, and I said, I ain't picking up the kit, and I just walked out. So the boys were a bit shocked by that, and so like nobody used to say no to Gerry, and you know, I respected him at the time, but I just thought he was out of order and, you know, making me pick up the kit in front of people. So I just went on the bus. And in them days, we used to stop at the fish and chip shop and get our fish and chips on the way home. So we did that. And so we're all eating fish and chips, and I'm at the back with the lads having a few beers because we all drank on the return journeys in them days. And Gerry came down the bus, and he said, Paul, I need to speak with you about you not putting the kid up. And I said, oh, just leave me alone, Gerry. Get lost.
Straight. He's walked down to the back of the bus. Rookie era.
So
get to the Lions then.
So everybody's just looked at me and gone, Nikko, you didn't say that, did you? And I went, look, I'm upset. So we're driving along the bus, and then the driver said, listen up, Jody's got something to say. So he got on the speaker and he said, we're pulling into the next service station. Everybody on the bus needs to leave it. Nikko, you stay on the bus. Now, in them days, we had press on the bus.
Oh, right.
So the press were on the bus.
Like the local rag?
Yeah. Yeah. So even he left, and we had our... I found out afterwards, we had our PFA representative, Jeff Twentyman, the son of the great Twentyman from Liverpool.
Oh, wow.
I don't know. And so, but he didn't want the confrontation with Gerry, so he got off the bus. So Gerry came down to where I was sitting, and he started talking to me, and I just said, look, Gerry, maybe I was out of order what I said, but you're bang out of order not telling me that I'm getting dropped.
Yeah,
you should have come up and told me. Well, as soon as I said that, he hit me. So I had to jump on him.
Defend yourself.
So
we've this is still on the bus.
On the bus. So we've had a bit of a bear hug and all this and that, and then I've gotten up and I've walked off the bus and I'm all ruffled up, and the physio came up to me and he went, Paul, what's happened? I said, well, Gerry's just come and hit me. And he went, oh, that's out of order. And I went, oh, bloody hell, you know, get the police here.
Wow.
So somebody phoned for the police. The police came, and like, I thought, oh my goodness, what have we done? So the police arrested me and Gerry because we both had conflicting stories.
Yeah, but you did. Was his story that you swung first?
Yeah, well, yes.
Yeah. So, did you get an ear on him though?
Yeah.
Did you land?
I might
couple?
Have hugged him.
Yeah, right. Gotcha. What was it? What was a 27-year-old Nikko like in the scrapping department? Could you look after yourself?
Yeah.
Mean streets of Gisborne, probably. Yeah.
Look, I wasn't frightened of him, but I was in the situation. I was like, oh my God, how can I be fighting with my team manager on a football bus? It's like, it was crazy.
Which is why I think the analogy is important, to put it into perspective. If it was a Tim Payne type character going to play for a Lampard, because he was a year older than you, but he was a England skipper. He was only 28.
Yeah, how's that? 38. Johnny was 38.
Okay. Paper's got it wrong.
Yeah.
I can't trust
was it 28? No.
Johnny was only a year older than you. In the
no, Johnny was 38.
That, that's the thing, Nikko. Don't trust the media. And that's where Stephen operates.
No, he'd been manager at Bristol Rovers for two years.
Yeah, right. But regardless, you've gone over. This is your first or second year at Bristol.
Yeah, it's within 6-7 months of signing.
So you've gone from Gisborne as a semi-pro, whatever you were in New Zealand, to the second tier of English football, and you've got the confidence in yourself to be dropped and to get and to tell the coach to fuck off and to fight him on the, like, where does that backbone come from? Is that just something that you've always had? Well summarized, Steve.
It's followed me, I think, since the age of 5, when if I think somebody's done a wrong to me, I'll stand up and confront it and then think about the consequences afterwards. Sometimes it works, sometimes it really backfires. I think in this situation it backfired on me in my relationship with Gerry, because even though the club saved me contract, because they could have sacked me for it, they honoured my contract until the end.
And you, how long after that incident did you stay at Rovers before you came back to New Zealand?
6 years.
Oh, wow.
So, but it was the catalyst for me to move into Asia, because even though Gerry, we shook hands on it, and he said what had happened was just spur of the moment, and we were both immature in fighting, and he said he would just look upon me as an ordinary player, which I took him at his word. But from that moment on, my ability to get in the first team was like limited around. I had to be on 100% match form, otherwise I wasn't in. And you know, so if there was somebody going to get dropped, it was me. And probably 7-8 months later, when we were in the middle of a season, I got dropped again, and I went and had a good heart to heart with Gerry, and he agreed to let me go on loan to Asia.
The Eastern Athletic, is that where you...
Yeah, I signed, yes, for a team called Eastern Athletic, Dongfeng, in Hong Kong, and I stayed there 5 seasons.
Wow. Let's get into that. Let's get into the Hong Kong scene. Mm. 5 years there. How good was the money?
It was quite good in them days. 1990 to 1995, they would give me cash around about £10,000-£15,000 cash signing on fee for every season that I signed on for. They would give me a separate win bonus, and I can't remember. We used to get paid cash from managers that were attached to our team. So it might not be in your wage packet, but depending on the game, they might give us like 5,000 New Zealand dollars to win a game.
Sounds.
And so...
And what, like half of that if you drew or lost, or nothing? Is it like
nothing,
an all or nothing?
Yeah, all or nothing, but you know.
Proper win bono.
Yeah, we would still be on our contracted win bonus. Right. You know, might be like 1,000, 2,000, 3,000 Hong Kong, which is around about $600 or $700, I think, in them times. But then I used to get a weekly wage plus a living allowance.
So was 5 years in Hong Kong enough to financially set yourself up for life? Like, it's hard to sort of look at the money then and what it's worth now, but did it put you basically in a really good position, or were you kind of grinding still at that level?
No, put me in a position where I can come back to New Zealand. Obviously, my wife on was a Kiwi, and, you know, banking the money and putting it into our housing has allowed us to financially secure, you know, our future from the age of 35.
Mm.
So, you know, having 4 children is quite expensive.
how much?
Aaron, you're listening. Yeah.
How much truth is there in you lending Roger Wilkinson videotapes of you playing in Hong Kong so that a young Sam Wilkinson could watch them and improve his game? Any truth to that at all?
Yes. I don't know if they were used for that. I think maybe Roger was looking out to attack properly.
Good, very good.
Yeah.
But Hong Kong in the 90s is different to now. Was it still under British rule? Was it?
Yes.
Because it seemed like quite a popular destination for
it. I left the season before Hong Kong changed over to China.
1995.
Which was, no, it was 96.
Damn it.
96,
90, 90, 96, 97. Just hold your phone, mate.
So, you know, at the time, there was good money there to be made. And so it was very vibrant. Chinese were very hard clubs to play for, because if you didn't fulfill your potential, you were only there 3 months and they'd get rid of you.
Oh, wow.
And so I was lucky enough to last 5 years and stay with the one club or the one team manager that looked after me. And it bore fruition in that we won the league championship for the last 3 years of my career. We won the championship, and we won about, I think, 4 cup finals, and we played in the Asian European equivalent cup,
Champions League or whatever.
We would go to Korea, Japan, and just play in some fantastic stadiums.
Very good. So I said we're going to jump around a little bit, so I want to fast forward now to 2003. And that was the last year that I played with you as my coach. We made the Chatham Cup final. So what I want to hone in on, which may not be a surprise to you, is what exactly happened with you and Declan in that final. Because I want to say it from my perspective. We had an amazing team that year. It was probably, it was my first, well, maybe second proper season of senior football, but it was the team that I still remember most fondly because it was a bunch of teenagers and giant killers, and we had such a great team spirit. And you and Declan, I don't know what age you would have been, maybe late 30s, 40-ish.
I was 40.
You were kind of on the verge of being one of the lads and having that sort of bit of separation. Now, as far as I knew, everything was rosy up until final day. I didn't know of any, I didn't hear of any, I was only 17, so I may have been oblivious, but I didn't hear of any sort of tension between you two until after the final. And I don't think I was even aware of it during the build-up to the final, but from what I understand, Declan had asked that his kids be allowed to sit on the bench, and that was the catalyst for an argument which turned into a fight, which turned up into both of you eventually going your separate ways.
Yeah.
So talk to me about what you remember from that.
Me and Declan have made up. We're very good friends at the moment, but at that time it was like really something that split us apart. Declan is godfather to Matthew. I'm godfather to Harry.
Were these godfather rights pre 2003?
Yes.
Yeah, okay.
So we were very close as a family. Wilmer got on really well with his ex-wife, Curry, from Australia, who was the sister of a player that I played with at Gisborne, Kevin Maycock, who was a very good player. So we were very close, and me and Wilmer were very supportive of Declan and what was happening within his family at that time. And things weren't right between him and his wife, and it was, you know, affecting the children. And so Declan had more of the boys at that, in that season. I think Curry had maybe left the household, but we still had contact with her. And, you know, now and again, the boys used to come and watch us. But never once can I remember them being in the dugout during the season. And then on cup final week, Declan came up to me and he went, "Look, Nikko, I've talked to Harry and Joseph. And I've told Joseph, Harry's sitting in the dugout and Joseph's in the stand. Because Harry's beaten more games than Joseph." And so I listened to him and I went, "What, you really want them in the dugout in the cup final?" And he went, "Yep." And I went, "Okay, yeah. I'm going to have to go away and think about this, Declan." So I went away, spoke to Wilma, spoke to Curry, and we came to the decision that Harry couldn't sit in the dugout. Now, when I had to relay that decision to Declan, got really upset, and to the point that he said he would seriously think about pulling out in cup final week and not attending the cup final. So we had the training sessions, and I just said, "Look, we just gotta get through this and keep it in house, and just me and you. If you go, you go. I want you to stay."
Yeah.
You know, like, yeah, I don't want you to go because I'm not letting Harry stay, but I've made the decision And I just think you have to respect that. And we'll just carry on.
Was there a hierarchy between you two?
I was the boss.
Right.
Okay. You know?
I always thought it was co-coaches, but that's again from the outside looking in.
No.
But I guess it goes back to your strong backbone again, because was there any point when you thought he was seriously going to walk away that you thought about just fuck it, let him on the bench?
In that week, no. I was adamant that I was right for the family, for Declan and for his boys. I had no hesitation.
Right.
I just thought Declan would come round to my thinking. You know, because we were good friends. Well, it just got worse during the week, and Declan would not clarify whether he was going to be part of it or not. Up until the point where we got up there on the Saturday night, and there was still the possibility that he would just pack his bags and go. So. We had Ray Pooley there, who I had spoken to, and said, look, this is a situation, briefed them fully on it. And I said, look, you talk to them, let's see if we can just get through it. So Ray talked to them, and what Ray indicated to me was, Declan said, I should leave. And Ray and Declan take the team for the cup final day.
That makes sense. Yeah, that's it. Logical.
So Ray passed this on to me, and I went, well, Ray, that ain't happening. And Ray went, I know that, Nikko. So what do we do, Ray? So Ray went, let's just get through the day. Deck, are you going to be in there? And Declan said, yeah, right. So we got on to it, but Declan wouldn't speak to me in the cup final.
Like on the bench, like standing alongside each other.
Wouldn't speak to me.
Oh my God.
Just.
Did you know that when you were on the pitch?
No.
No idea.
I didn't know any of this. It's a long time ago now, but.
Yeah. I was cool because the most important thing was not me and Declan, was the team.
Yeah.
You know, and I'm glad you said that, like you weren't aware of anything. So that meant that there was no distraction for the team. Now, we went out that day and we got firmly beat. But the reason we got firmly beat was because, and I've never told him, Gavin Douglas got injured. Now, if Gavin Douglas had not gotten injured after we went 1-0 up, I think we would have went on and won.
He missed that header, didn't he, for the equaliser? I think he didn't quite jump properly. This is what Gav says anyway.
We had to take him off, didn't we? Once we took Gavin Douglas off, they put two goals on us. He was, I think he might have been at fault for the first goal because of his ankle. I can't remember. I haven't looked at the game since 2003.
Have you really not watched it ever again?
No.
Wow.
No. Why would you?
No. So after that, then. What happens? He leaves.
He leaves the Monday.
He leaves.
I said, look, Declan, I still want you here. We've still got a few games left.
Yeah, still league games left, isn't it?
Still league games. We were in a relegation battle.
Yeah, I remember.
I said, Declan, I still want you here. Look, you might think I've made the wrong decision, but I still want you here until the end of the season. And he went, nah, it's not happening, Nikko.
Okay.
So I went, okay then, see you later, and I'll have to, you know, get on with it myself. And Ray Pooley helped me for the last about three games, which were critical games. Yeah. And fortunately, we got the result we needed against Ellerslie in the last game. Might have been two games
to
go. He
was gone as well. Yeah, I was off. I went to America a few days after the final.
So we're on a big low after the cup final. And, you know, to survive relegation, I think we had a team good enough. We just were in a very awkward situation. And so to survive it was good.
So he left, you went your separate ways. How many years until you talked to him again?
Might have been 7 years.
Was it? That's crazy. Yeah, but things are good now.
Yeah.
Yeah, your best mates again.
Yeah. And, you know, we haven't talked about the actual me not letting him have his son on the bench, but we now have getting over that and just said, hey, look, people have different opinions, different attitudes. We look at everything differently, you know, but that's not reason enough to fall out and walk away from each other, you know. So I've never said, look, Declan, I made the wrong decision, and if I made the right decision based on what you said, Declan, we would have won the Chatham Cup. I've just, I haven't.
Yeah, I think we've established it was Gavin Douglas's fault.
Sounds like it. Fucking Gav.
About time someone called him on his shit.
Oh, that's fascinating. That is so, it's classic two strong-willed people, isn't it? You don't, you go from being best mates and godfathers to each other's children and hanging out every day and talking on the phone how many times a day to not talking for 7 years. That's just classic, isn't it?
Well, now I speak to him, I message him in Sweden, 3 o'clock in the morning. How are you, Declan? but knowing Declan, Declan is on another atmosphere. He's on another level. And I think that people find that a challenge dealing with him.
Yeah.
Whereas I can deal with that now.
You played together before you coached together? Like Gisborne, is that right? Am I wrong?
No. When I came back in 95, 96... Declan was playing for Waikato in the Super League for Roger. I think his dad had been sacked the month before I started playing with him, and Roger took over. So we had a forward line of Declan, Dash, and me.
Decent forward line.
Right, and it was quite funny because Dash was saying Declan doesn't pass to him. Declan was saying Dash don't pass to him, and then I was in the middle, and like I was thinking, what's going on here? And like there was a very strange combination, and we got to the super final against Waitakere, and I came across Danny Hay, who I'd never played against before, and he was the standout player in that game, and we got beat 5-0 in the cup final.
Wow. That was it? 96.
So I've gone canvassed a few opinions about the best things to ask Nikko about, and I was told, and I think it was 96, but it doesn't sound right because I think it was you and Darren Melville were maybe co-coaches, and there was the famous plane trip back from Woolston with Daryl Ward was naked the whole flight. And there was a huge blow up about it. Were you co-coaching at that time? Were you involved in that incident? What do you remember?
Yeah, it cost me $5,000. We got fined $5,000 by the NZFA. And I think it was the only time that maybe Waikato United have been live on TV on One Network News. And I was coming out of the hearing.
I thought you were going to say they were at the airport waiting for the group to come off the plane.
It was a very...
They were charter flights, is that right?
Passengers on.
Yeah, yeah.
Just the pilot. The just the pilot. Yeah. And a Waikato team. So no body from the public.
Yeah.
So we did... played cards on the way back, and I mixed the cards up so it would make Darryl lose.
so every card had his name on it. So you were the coach at the time?
Yes, I was co-coach with Darren Melville.
Okay.
So me and Darren came up with a plan. You know, but it was on the way back, wasn't on the way down.
So you were you were both player coaches?
Yes, yeah.
And how old would you have been? Late 30s?
34.
Okay.
It's a good age. Right.
34.
So you're still looking to get after it a little bit. You were still one of the lads, obviously.
Yeah, I mean, me and Darren were the co-coaches, and I think there was only Archie Gemmell, God rest his soul, was in older in the team.
Hmm. Right.
And the rest were a bunch of young lads, Waikato lads, that, you know, would give their heart to play for Waikato. And in them days, everybody liked a beer after the game. And so we were a very joyful team.
It's not a long flight. Must have been a lot of hands played.
So he's naked the yes. whole flight.
Yes.
The pilots become aware of it, and then word gets out to the authorities.
I think the pilot reported us to the authorities, and we had to go up. And,
please explain.
Please explain.
You and Darren Melville both had to go to court together.
Just me.
It's just you. You were the face of it.
I was the face. So I was the one that said, "Look, I'll go up and I'll say sorry," which we were. But you know, we didn't mean any harm to anybody. It was just in house, and we got fined for it.
Yeah, fun and games.
Mm.
Can I go right back and ask how you actually ended up in New Zealand? Because I don't know I don't know that story.
Mm-hmm. You can.
Good question.
Good bloody good question. Yeah, that's why he's here.
Yeah, pride myself on my good questions.
I was around about 20 at the time, and I was playing semi-pro in England, and I got the offer to go down to Rochdale, who were a pro club, by a famous Sunderland player, Vic Allen, played in the 1973 Cup Final. So he was an idol for me. So I went down there for pre-season, and they put me up in a bed and breakfast, and I was expecting to get paid pre-season, and I approached the manager yet again and asked him where my weekly money was, and he said, "Look, we can't afford it. You need to sign on the dole while you're at pre-season." And I thought that was unacceptable, so I left. So that disillusioned me a bit. And then I had a friend in New Zealand called Keith Swansbury, played for Rotorua. And I bumped into him in one of my league games. He was back on holiday, and he mentioned he was in New Zealand, said it was a good league to play in. So he gave me a contact, and I responded to that contact, and that contact was Roger Wilkinson.
Right.
So at that time Roger was at Napier, and he got all my details and made a few phone calls to my coaches that had coached me in England, and he made the decision to bring me out then. But what happened was he was getting a sack at Napier. He knew he was getting a sack, so he didn't bring me out straight away. He waited until he went to Claudelands Rovers. And I remember the call. I'm at my girlfriend's in Pete Lee. And it's either New Year's Eve on the afternoon or New Year's Day on the afternoon. And the phone went off at my girlfriend's. The mother answered it and said, "Paul, there's a call from New Zealand." And I went, "What?" So I went up and I went, "Hello?" And he said, "This is Roger Wilkinson. I speak to Paul Nixon." I went, "Yeah." And he went, "I'm coaching at a..." I can't remember what he said, but he said, "Do you want to come to New Zealand?" And I went, "Yeah, when can you get me out?" And he went, "Well, I'll have you out in a week." And I went, "Yeah, send me the tickets, please." Put the phone down. Girlfriend went, "What was that?" I said, "I'm off to New Zealand."
That was it.
I made the decision, and I was out within a week, and that's when I arrived in Hamilton and played for Claudelands Rovers under
the connection,
the tutelage of Roger for two seasons.
Mm. So I want to try to understand the personality of Paul Nixon, and I want to talk from personal experience, because I want to go back to around 2000, and I was 14 or 15 playing in the Melville youth team. So you would have been maybe mid-40s or early 40s. You'd had this amazing career, really successful career, years in England and Hong Kong and All Whites caps and done it all, National League. And there you are. You used to be able to play a few overage players in that youth team. So you would play some games because you still loved getting out there.
In 2000?
And around, yeah, it would have been around 2000.
Yeah, so that's the same, the pre-season time.
Yeah.
Nikita so, Miha took his spot.
So,
Mickey.
Yeah. So what I remember so vividly...
You got married last year.
Oh, there you go. Yeah.
From you, is that when you stepped onto the field for the youth team, you were a fucking psycho. Like frothing at the mouth if you didn't get the ball, bollocking 13 and 14 year olds. Like, people were scared of you. They're like, why does he care so, like, why is he this fired up for a youth team game when he's played at the highest level? And like, what is going on here? So I guess because off the field you're such a laid back, placid character, but in a youth team game after your career's finished, you're like acting like that. What's going on there?
I'm not too sure. I'm not sure if I, you know, was like that at my peak, you know, whether when I crossed the line, I turn into another person, you know, that's, you know, needs to win, you know, needs everything to go right, you know, or whether it's just that maybe I was older, you know, was playing in a game of football where things weren't happening the way I wanted to happen, you know, and maybe that was a bad side coming out of me.
The frustration.
I'm not too sure.
Were you a father at that stage, 2000?
Yeah.
Okay.
It's similar.
Maybe they were just useless players.
there's a few other characters I'd put in that same category of really nice, laid back off the field, fucking animals on it. Chad Coombs and Danny Robinson would be two that I would highlight. But it's interesting, and it sort of spilled over into your coaching too. I remember when things were good, things were really good, but when things were going wrong, you would lose your head on the sideline. Dog shit was a favourite quote that I think got thrown out quite a lot. But I guess the question is, after 2003, the coaching kind of stopped, and that you did one more season and then you never really coached again at that level. Is that right? Is there a reason why you didn't continue coaching?
I think it was linked into my experience with Declan. It had a negative effect on me. And I wasn't too overly driven to go up that coaching ladder. I thought I was, but then I realised I wasn't. You know, did I want to reach the top in New Zealand? And I looked at it and I went, look, it's not the resources that I'm used to and clubs that I played for to you know, make it nice and smooth. You have to employ your job, your coaching career together and make some big sacrifices to get up there. And my heart wasn't in it. And I just drifted away from it, from men's football.
Was it around that time you went down the teaching route?
Yeah, that's when I went down. I put myself into university for 3 years, and then I focused on that, on my university.
At age what?
I think.
And was that your first time at uni, at age 40-ish?
I think I was about 38.
38. Yeah, you've said 40 before in 2000.
I was about 37, 38, because I was born in 63.
Yeah, it's a good age.
So I left school at 16.
Right.
Without any qualifications. So.
And how was the adult student?
I loved it.
Yeah?
Yeah. I loved university because it was that easy. I thought it was going to be hard.
Yeah.
But it wasn't.
What about Tuckeroa High School? Was that hard?
No. Teaching is, if I'm honest, I'm blessed to be a teacher. I'm a good teacher.
Mm. Oh, good.
And so it comes naturally to me.
You're a good coach too, Nikko. I love the years at Boys High and that youth team. You had a really good understanding of the player management side of things, making it fun and keeping people interested. And yeah, there's a good balance.
I think the tennis side of me is something that I've tried to control at certain times in my life. and sometimes it gets uncontrollable in certain situations.
Well, Gerry Francis found that in 1988.
But even over silly things like referee decisions, if I see a referee decision that actually changes the course of the game, whether it's under 15s, it's the Northern Premier League, it's a schoolboy game, I can't let go of it.
Yeah.
It just drives me nuts.
How's the meditation going? You found inner peace?
I have had professional support for it. I've learned to be able to calm myself.
Is that where the 15-minute naps come in?
Yes.
Power naps?
Yeah.
I've heard about those.
Yeah, I
in a crowded staff room?
I can go to sleep anywhere for 15 minutes.
Yeah, I've heard.
Yeah.
It's a skill.
Just turn off.
Wow.
And just...
Always 15? You never 15, yeah. slide into 45
no, no,
hour?
15.
It's always, a disciplined 15.
It's timed 15 minutes.
Wow. It's a real skill. Nick, I want to touch on something which obviously has shaped the second half of your life. Your wife Wilma passed away over a decade ago and left you to sort of raise four kids.
Mm.
How did that tragedy shape both your personal outlook, the way that you carried yourself, and the way that you approach the rest of your life?
You know, it wasn't long after the cup final in 2003 that Wilma was diagnosed with cancer. So Wilma was diagnosed with cancer about 2004, 2005. So I think that had a major effect on how I viewed my coaching career and how maybe what direction I should go. So that made me more of a family man, focused on the children, on their growing up, on their ability to love football, because we did make them play football. But they did have a choice. Not only for them. So, I think it took the wind out of my sail for football coaching, and it's just something I've had to deal with. But even if Wilma was alive today, I still think I was heading away from coaching, just because it just didn't grab me as football playing did.
Mm.
To play and coach are two completely different things, but the way I look at it, you still have to get that same pleasure out of it. And I couldn't get that same high that I used to get when I played.
Mm.
I knew I could coach good, but I just never used to get that same high. And I used to really over-analyze everything. Because, as a player, I was very good at analysing situations and coming up with a solution straight away. But as a coach, it just used to go round and round my head about trying to come up with a proper game plan, a proper solution, what was happening in the game. And it used to, I couldn't sleep.
Mm.
And it just, boom, boom, boom. And me and Declan used to talk about things like this. And obviously Declan has been able to harness that, whereas I've let it go. I just, I don't feel right in that environment anymore.
So the kids have all grown up now.
Yeah.
Any burning desire to coach again, or is it gone?
I'm thinking now I might.
He's back.
I might, if given an opportunity, come in and be somebody's support staff.
A Ray Pooley role.
I'd rather be an assistant, a proper assistant,
Yeah.
Not a Ray Pooley, because Ray just sits on the outside.
Floated.
And I want to be the number two of a young coach. you know, that
like an Aaron Scott,
you like an Alan Scott,
yeah,
something like that.
And linking the podcast guests here, Aaron was in, just, you know, talking about his coaching ambitions. Yeah. Make a perfect fit.
Well, okay, yeah, that's where I might see myself going, you know, in the future. I'm just,
you'd make a great number two, because like I said, I think your strength was your connection, you know, your people skills. Yeah. You're able to connect with different people, yeah, on different levels. Mm. So it's an important skill to have, I guess. To close that family loop, how do you feel that your daughter Holly now has more power in New Zealand football than you do?
Blessed.
what is Holly's official shout out? Holly Nixon,
Women's Development Manager, soon to be on maternity leave. You're about, yeah, to be a grandfather.
Yes,
the first time.
Due December 31st.
Yeah,
my,
that's
first,
right,
grandchild.
Big New Year's Eve in the Nixon house.
another phone call like the one in England. Yeah, Paul, it's Rog here. Congratulations, you're a grandfather.
You made peace with being a granddad. You ready for that?
Yeah, I'm ready. Yeah, it's come at the right time, you know, because all the children have left. Georgie, my youngest, is 20 now. Matthew's 22. Jessica's 24, and Holly's 28. So they're all left the house, leading their own lives, and so it's time for me now, and I've got plenty of time.
Mm. And have you just had the one, just Holly's wedding, the one wedding in the...
One wedding, one next November, and Maddie lives with his girlfriend.
Oh, right. Just because on the wedding theme, you famously missed Stephen's wedding. can you talk us through that? Believe you turned up the day
I
after?
I have some, you know, like, it's now and again that crisis will occur in my life. And when it does... Things don't go good.
Just on that, Sam Wilkinson's invited you to his wedding in January. He's waiting on an RSVP, so if you could let Wilkie know if you're coming or not, that would be appreciated.
Let him know, Wilkie. He's undecided.
I've lost the invite.
Yeah. Oh, well, you are invited.
I know, but what day is it?
4th of January.
Okay, then. Right.
We'd love to see you there.
Just to fill the listeners in on that gag, I'll tell the story from my perspective. It was the wedding day, and everyone's arrived at the wedding. Beautiful. The wife's put, you know, years of work into it, and there's a table right near the front. Nikko was actually at the family table, and there were two seats missing. I said, who the fuck isn't turned up? And it was Nikko and his partner. And I thought, oh, gee, I wonder what's going on there. Didn't think about it again. Had a great night. And the next morning, I wake up in the honeymoon suite with the wife, and I get a message quite early. It was about 7 o'clock that we were up. And I was like, oh, okay, well, who's that? Nikko. Hey, Steve. Lost the invite because we're moving house. Just wanted to know what time the wedding starts today.
You missed one of the all-time greats.
And then I've replied and said, oh, Nikko, the wedding was yesterday, mate. You've missed it. And I could tell you were like, I was like, there's a barbecue today, though, so you're welcome to go. I was like, I'll be right there. And I think you were there within an hour and a half, and then you felt so bad. You turned up to the barbecue, and you apologised for about 2 hours.
Sorry to bring that back up, but it's just too good a story, especially with the Wilkinson wedding on the horizon.
Yeah.
You did miss one of the all-time great weddings. It was actually less of a wedding and more of a roast, the way that the speeches went down with our dear friend Stephen.
Yeah, the old man got up and gave a speech. He probably spoke for about 20 to 25 minutes. I think he might have mentioned my wife once, if that, right at the end, but the majority of the time he spent reciting Melville stats for people in the audience. He picked a football team out of...
true story.
Out of the best 11 he could make from people at the wedding, so...
I don't know if you made that, actually.
I guess looking back, it was one of the more memorable speeches, you know. So shout out Bruiser if you're listening. I know, yeah, you will be. Yeah. People are still talking about your wedding speech. So
a lot of
well done.
Angst between Byron and I about who got the number one jersey. Yeah. I nudged it for him.
Yeah.
That might have been a reason why maybe my coaching career hasn't got anywhere, because of my speeches. Something that really I've never refined.
Just on your coaching career, you must have coached a lot of talented kids over the years. Is there anyone that stands out as being
particularly?
My favourite one is Paulie Nixon.
Let's go
and say family.
Yeah, if you can't say family, let's go outside of that. And it's Holly Payne.
Oh yes.
Can make your peace with that.
Don't say Matthew Nixon.
No, I won't. I've had lots of good talent from Boys Eye and Melville, and when I've taken under 14 teams at Clodland's Rovers. Some outstanding talent, and you know, some players you expect to go on to bigger, better things, and they don't, you know. And I just sometimes think to myself, why not? You know, what do I see in them players that other teams and coaches don't see? And so, you know, like Stephen, Mr. Holloway, Andrew Blake, you know, that talented players that I think should be professionals. Logan Rogerson's just been released from Germany.
Well, both Blakey and Logan are at Auckland City now, linked back up again.
You know, and I think when I compare them to what I see in England, there's no difference. And what I remember when I went to Bristol Rovers and trained with the professionals there, and they give me my contract, I was playing with them, I'm thinking, wow, I'm better than these players. And like, they've had pro careers since they were 18, and I went in at 25.
Oh, wow.
And I was, and then when I went up the league, I still felt the same. When I went to Asia, and they used to bring out ex-England internationals, and I used to watch them play and play against them. And I think, wow, you know, I'm just as good as them.
So do you think it's a self-belief thing?
I self-belief and just giving the opportunity. I think, you know, you just have to be lucky, right place, right time, and just have that, you know, where somebody opens the door for you, and then you go.
Two of those three guys you mentioned, they've still got a chance though, don't they? Because you didn't actually turn pro until you were, what, 26?
25, 26.
And Logan and Blakey, they'd both be young. They'd be 20.
Logs
22.
Yeah, Logs 21, and Blakey's 23,
24. Yeah. Well, I wish them the best. I think
they'll be listening.
I think it's hard though. Once you've gone there, getting rejected, you come back to New Zealand. Where are you going to go after that?
Need a good agent.
Are you going to? Are you strong enough to go back out? I think that's the main barrier, you know.
If there are any players out there looking for an agent to represent them, maybe give Seamus a DM. Find them on Facebook or Twitter.
Just message the page.
Between Two Beers Facebook page. Send us a DM if you're looking for representation. There may be someone here who's looking for that pathway.
Shot, bro.
Yeah, kia ora.
What a team.
It's all right, we're getting there. I've only got one other thing on my list. I like to prepare lists. I'm old school. Stephen just riffs it. So you qualified to play for the All Whites. You played in 1988, only I think it's four caps between 88 and 93.
It was like four caps and seven games. It was like 1987. Who was coach? Kevin Fallon. So I left Rovers after two seasons.
Down to Gizzy?
To Gisborne. Kevin Fallon was the coach of Gisborne the previous season. He was also the All Whites coach. So he left Gisborne, went to North Shore. Steve Sumner left Manuiwa, went to Gisborne, who was the All Whites captain. So both of them phoned me up to go and play for them, to sign, one for North Shore, one for Gisborne. So I said I would speak to them both, and I invited them both to my house. Steve Sumner made an arrangement to come up in a few days, and then Fallon was a day after him. After I got off the phone with Steve Sumner, he phoned me back and he said, Paul, I'm coming up now to talk to you. So he came up, give me a good contract in New Zealand terms. So I signed straight away. Kevin Fallon phoned me back the next day and said, when's a good time to come? And I said, look, it's not Kevin. I've signed for Gisborne City. And I think he said, fuck you. Put the phone down. So that was the national coach saying, fuck you. So I thought, well, that's not very good for me aspirations of being an all-white. I had them aspirations. Because right. When I came out, when Roger brought me out, within 6 weeks, we were playing against the New Zealand all-whites in an invitational team. Kevin Keegan was playing for all of us, so I was partnering Kevin Keegan up front. And we destroyed the all-whites. The all-whites won, but I had a good game and I made a reputation for myself. So I knew at the end of my 2 years, I was loyal to Roger, that I'd do my 2 years. And if we weren't National League, I was moving on. We applied for National League that year and they turned us down. So I went to Gisborne City.
Right.
So when I played that first year at Gisborne City, I had a good season. And when I played against North Shore, I made sure that I used to ram it down Fallon's throat, to the point where we knocked them out in the semi-final and I scored both goals. And then he came in the bar and he went, Paul, you're not a bad player. And I went, yeah, thanks, Kevin. From that, he then brought me into the New Zealand team for their Olympic tour. And I played in it, and it was a catastrophe. It was a bad tour. It just, Declan Edge, his dad, Eddie, was co-coach. And he resigned halfway through it.
Halfway through the game?
Halfway through the tour. No. It was like a 7 week tour that we went on. And he resigned from it. So it wasn't a good tour that I enjoyed. And so after that, I went back to Gisborne. And I got an ankle injury that put me out for half a season. Mm. So I didn't have any association with the All Whites again until I went overseas. I was playing for Bristol Rovers and then they approached me to come back into the fold. By that time, it was a Scottish manager. Oh, what was his name? Christchurch. Can't remember.
Gould.
No. Can't remember. So I was playing.
Joe McGrath, not Joe McGrath. He's Irish.
No, I was playing in Asia at the time, and he brought me over for a game in Singapore. So I played in this game, and me and Billy Wright played up front. We were the strike partnership for Rovers, 4 years previous to that. So I impressed, and he said, "I'd like you to come in for the World Cup qualifiers." I went, yeah, it's fantastic, I'll come in.
World Cup 1990?
Something like that. Maybe 94, something like that, I can't remember.
So, yeah, maybe I'm doing you a disservice, sorry.
So, yeah, it might have been 94.
USA 94.
Yeah.
Hell of a tournament.
And so we said, I'll bring you in. I went, yeah, just fly me in for the games. I'll come in a couple of days. He went, no, we'll bring you in for 6 weeks. Nah. I said, I'm playing in a top professional league in Asia. I can't leave that league for 6 weeks. And he went, well, if you can't, we'll invoke the FIFA law on you and make you come. And I went, well, you can try. And so we went down that avenue and I refused to play for him based on him saying I had to be here for 6 weeks. Mm. So that killed my career.
Yeah. Nikko, what was it that made you such a good player? Because I remember, again, going back to your coaching days, you would lead the finishing drills, you'd show us how it was done, and I remember just absolutely clinical, just sort of passing it into the bottom corner. You know, it seemed like you did that so easily and so naturally. Was that the strength, was that your biggest strength, your finishing, or was it the understanding or your pace, or what made you so successful?
I think it was a combination of my ability to finish, but I also was a good link player. So the teams that I played in played through me. And so I would dictate every, you know, attacking move. So I was on the ball a lot. So I had that ability to, you know, where put my presence on that field and really make things happen. And finishing was just natural, you know, like balls would come in and you would just do something and you know what you were doing and it would end up where you wanted to go in the back of the net. And but it would just happen within a second and it was just natural ability.
So did you find it hard transitioning into a coach to teach that to people?
Absolutely. I found it a real struggle passing that natural ability on how you think. You know, I would talk about finishing and what has the picture that you get in your head, where how you've got to strike the ball, but with different angles in your feet, you know, and reacting quickly and knowing which side you're going to preempt the strike from. But I found that hard to coach. It just was something that just used to be natural for me, that I when the ball came over, my touch was exceptional. I had an exceptional touch and I could just put the ball wherever I wanted. Mm-hmm. And just, it was something that, you know, I always practiced.
Do you put that down to wearing your boots all day on an away game? Because that's another little nugget of wisdom that I've heard.
Where does that come from, Nikko?
Is that a real thing?
Did I actually say that?
Well, you used to do it.
Did I?
You wear your boots from the moment we got off the bus until you got back on the bus.
Being a coach or a player?
Coach.
Wow. I wasn't aware of that. I always used to like wearing them Puma boots. Maybe it was just a fetish that I had.
Well, I've also heard that you bought a pair of $30 active boots from the warehouse in 2003. You got hammered mercilessly by the team to the point where they disappeared and you bought a proper pair of football boots.
Well, if somebody's told you that, it must be true.
Yeah.
I am known for being a bit miserly.
Yeah.
So that might have been that.
You're also known for I'm not sure this is correct, but never wearing studded boots. You'd always wear moulds. I remember the boggiest, shittiest pitches in Auckland. I'd be like, Nicko, what the fuck are you doing? Put some studs on. He's like, no, you've got to have your balance.
So you're about to try to do...
I very nearly went into the Nicko voice.
Yeah, I'd love for you to try and do that accent.
And I just held back. But is that true? You never wear studs?
No, never. I did. I would have worn them at Rovers, but then when I went to Asia, I just wore moulds until I retired.
Harder pitches, probably, over there.
On
a monsoon
but,
season.
You know, like that was the time when moulds were really good studs, though. You know, you didn't need just your six studs, which were quite long. Moulds were being developed into proper, you know, proper like studs.
A nice mould on an active boot, you know, they really knew what they were doing back in the early thousands.
You know, I don't want to make you feel bad, but it was probably a present from my children, them active boots.
Ah, yeah. Wilkie, you are family.
That's it. Wilkie, taking the knife in me.
He's got a couple of stories. Is he? Up his sleeve.
Yeah, I don't know where he gets his stories from.
No, he tells a good Dan Mead. Well, actually, Dan Mead tells a good story about an Asian exchange student and an incident in Hamilton Boys High Gym where you burst in and suggested someone call an ambulance because there's been an accident. But
we'll leave that.
Nothing to do with football.
No.
I think he was on a trampoline and he tried a double flip and didn't come off.
Supervised, of course.
He's supervised. No.
Well, it's been a great chat, Nicko. I've had a request from Gav Douglas. He wanted the last question of the night, and he wanted to put you on the spot, and he didn't want any fence sitting. He said, you need to call it, are you a Melville man, or are you a Claudelands Rovers man?
It's a good question.
In this moment of time.
Right now. Present day, Nicko.
Well, I've been both.
That's sitting the coach.
That's exactly what Gavin didn't want.
Oh, is that what they're thinking?
Well, because you called Gavin out about being the reason Melville lost the 2003 Chatham Cup final, so I think it's only fair.
Yeah, but it's not his fault that he got injured.
Well,
he could have looked after himself a bit better. Maybe,
yeah, maybe if he had active boots or something like that, would have done better.
A lot of people are going to be listening to this podcast. It's very important. This is going to go far and wide in the Waikato football community. Are you a Claudelands man? Or are you a Melville man?
Well, on the present moment in time, I am a Rovers man.
Get out.
That's fine. That's fine. I do.
I'm only saying that because it's gone out. And if me Rovers mates hear that.
Yeah.
Fair enough. You're hearing that now, Rovers mates. Shay, you got anything else?
No.
Anything on your list?
No, my list is all ticked off. This has been thoroughly enjoyable. I've learnt a lot more about Nikko than just the legend, the dressing room legend that is Nikko, which was talked about so prominently by a lot of my friends.
You're talking about the showers.
Yeah. Yes, I am talking about the showers. The legend that is Nikko. Okay. But I've learnt a lot more and it's been pleasurable.
Yeah, it's been great. Thanks for joining us, Nikko. It's been an absolute pleasure. Second guess, now you know what a podcast is and is all about. So hopefully have you back sometime in the future.
Okay, so the last word is I have both Melville and Rovers in my heart.
Good.
Oh, there you go. This bloody good. All right. Cheers, Nikko.
Thank you.